was Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Inviting you over. We're going to have volunteers there. We'll have refreshments. But we just want you to see what we're doing. We have all these buildings now and different things. We have fantastic volunteers. And so we just want to see you to see the compassion and mercy of the Lord Jesus Christ in action over there. So thank you.
Thank you, Mark. So put that on your calendars. We'll just wander over after church. And if you've never wandered through, some of you, who's never been in any of those buildings? It'd be good just to walk through. There'll be some folks there just to take a tour, put some eyeballs on what God is actually doing there. That would be awesome. A couple of announcements. Some are in your worship folder, and then some came out on the e-news. I don't know. I heard one of their children downstairs. Sam and Genesis, where are you guys? Here? Way in the back. They may or may not have had child number 3 recently. Okay. So, congratulations to them. If you don't know Sam and Genesis, Sam's formal role is as our caretaker and lives in a little cottage right by the bridge. And so we've set up a meal train for them for just a couple weeks just to help them a little bit. Those of you that have had are outnumbered by your children, you remember back when there were more babies than you had people to corral them. So just a little bit of help with food as they get their feet under them, managing a third one. So look at that. Also, don't forget the Bill Ahu is on that list of meal train to sign up, and that was in the emails as well. So take a look at that. Bill's battling cancer and is at home. And the food is wonderful, but the truth is, if you don't know Bill, Bill just loves seeing people from the church come by. Not a long visit, just a stop by, here's a meal, how you doing, can we pray with you? And it just brings him great hope, okay, to do that. So take a look at that, the Lord so leads you on that one as well. Thank you for your participation. It's amazing to me that in a community, we can raise tens of thousands of dollars by selling people junk. I mean, stuff that they really need. We call it a rummage sale for the fire department here. And they raised, with your help, over $40,000.
Wow.
Just on that. I don't know the exact number, but I know it was over that. So thank you for your participation in buying junk. There was some good stuff in there. There really was. But you got rid of a whole bunch of junk out of your house and somebody else bought it. That's an amazing thing to me. The fire department benefits from it. So it happened. We've done it. You've done it. It's church. So let's confess. That's the way it works. Okay? The fire department is very grateful. So thank you for doing all of that. Would you join me in prayer for some of the things you mentioned, some of the folks? Cassie Miller, we'll have an update on her. Her and Zach are down in Houston now for cancer treatments, and so we'll have an update on that in the e-news next week. So if you're not signed up for e-news, it'd be a pretty good plug to do that. So if more information comes out in e-news than you get here in church, okay? So sign up for that. But join me in prayer, would you? Father, we're grateful to be able to support our fire department, to be able to support new families, to be able to support people who are hurting and sick. And yet, Father, we recognize our support touches lives, but you're the one that changes them. You're the one that heals them. You're the one that brings them hope. So we ask, Father, for your help on that. Might you bring hope to Bill. Might you bring healing to his body. Might you bring help to Sam and Genesis as they wrestle with number three here. Might you be with Cassie and Zach and as they're down in Houston, Father. Bring healing to Cassie's body, help her to tolerate treatments, give them wisdom on their daughter and decisions they make with Melanie, Lord, please. Father, we just pause too to say thanks for our international staff and workers around the world that we get to support. I ask that you watch over them. Some of them are in critical areas of the world, dangerous areas. Might you bring them safely today? Might their labors produce fruit in your honor and glory. Might you show us as a church how we continue to support and encourage them. And Father, this morning, we just say thank you for the generosity of your people. Thank you for the support that comes through this church to your work. Lord, might you bless those who sacrificially give. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Okay, even though we're inside, we still allow 1 minute, 37 seconds to stand up and get a second cup of coffee or say hi to somebody that you've never met before. Ready, set, go.
Thank you.
Christ have to come to redeem anything if it was good.
Romans chapter 6. We know that the old self was crucified with him in order that the body of sin might be brought to nothing, so that we no longer will be enslaved to sin. Being enslaved to something, does that sound good or bad? Bad. Romans chapter 8. For God has done what the law weakened by the flesh could not do. By sending his Son in the likeness of sinful flesh for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh. If Jesus had to come and die for something, that's an indication that this place is what? Good or bad?
Bad.
Bad. How did you answer in the beginning? You see, how you answer that question is going to guide you on how you vote on an awful lot of things. You see, because it's not that the person next to you is some horrible person, but theologically speaking, we are born with a sin nature the moment we came onto this planet. And because we have that sin nature, you and I have a propensity to do good or bad.
Bad.
First words out of a child's mouth. What?
No!
Right? None of you taught your children this. They just know it. And the entire role of a parent is teaching them how to be healthy, productive, kind people. Why? Because left on their own, they won't be. So, because human nature is what? Bad. And that dictates an awful lot. And when you do this, as more and more people populated the planet, history past tells us that they migrated from the hills and into places where there were more resources. And those places got a name, and we call those places what? Cities. And because more and more people were there, we need more and more structure. And more structure meant an authority had to be in place. Now, most of us here kind of have an authority in mind. If I say we need a higher power, we need a greater authority to run our lives because we're not so good at it, some of us would default to God. But a whole lot of people wouldn't. And yet, they're migrating into cities and they need a greater authority to help run their lives. Because why? Human nature is bad. And so the greater authority to run their lives, if it wasn't going to be God and human nature is bad, was going to be politics, governments. It was a natural outcome. The word politics comes from the Greek word polis, which means city. That's where it originated from. A more modern definition might be the art and science of government. And it is that higher authority that governs us, that decides all kinds of things. And a lot of them are emotionally charged. Here's just a few. The Constitution, foreign policy, military, immigration, gun control, funding the police, climate change, racial injustice, the economy, the Supreme Court, relationships with local and state governments, abortion, definition of marriage, LGBTQ+ rights, freedom of speech, and I could go on. None of which I'm going to talk about. But if you want to investigate those and how the Bible compares, this book will have some suggestions for it. But I am going to talk about culture, the world, the church, and some things that influence us, like this. Most of what people argue for is not politics. Partisanship. Partisanship is this. It's different than politics. They sound similar, but it's different. Partisanship is this. I'm committed to a particular favor or cause for a candidate. I want a certain candidate. I want a certain party. I want a certain policy. I am partisan towards that. I am committed towards that. No matter what data piece you give me, I am filtering through that already preconceived commitment. Do you understand what partisanship is? It means I've already committed my resources. I've already committed my bubble. Whatever you tell me, I'm going to filter through what I've already committed myself to. Okay. That is not a discussion. This is why it's so frustrating to listen to the news. It's so frustrating to read social media. It is not a discussion for the most part. It is partisanship. It is an already committed group of people saying, I dare you. It is a group of people on both sides.
Then we stop listening.
And when we stop listening, we stop learning. We should never be afraid to listen. I'll be honest with you. If I stop listening, I'm going to not have conversations with half my family. That's partisanship. And I would rather enter those conversations. Here's what people always want on their policies and politicians. They always want Jesus on their side. Everybody does it, right? Donkey, elephant, same issue, different viewpoints. And they both, listen to them long enough, they both will preach from a church to support this opinion. They both will share some Bible verses. Why? Because they want Jesus on the side of this issue, for this person. Okay? They want Jesus on their side. And they'll go to great lengths to prove Jesus' support. Now here's what the Bible says. Romans chapter 13. Let me just read it. Let every person be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God. And God has instituted those that exist. Therefore, whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed. And those who resist will incur judgment. For rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. But you have no fear of the one who is in authority. Then do what is good. You will receive his support or approval. We are supposed to follow our governing authorities. Nobody gets to office because God blinked and forgot. Understand that? In a few months, whoever's in office, God promises to use to accomplish his will, no matter their name, no matter their symbol, no matter their party. See, all of them will want to prove that Jesus is on their side. Here's the problem. Jesus didn't come to take sides. Jesus came to take over. And that's where we get it all wrong. You see, Jesus came to take over. He created donkeys and elephants. He wanted always to be the king over all people. Jesus' goal is not a hostile takeover of the human heart, but rather a radical transformation of every man, woman, and child. That's Jesus' goal. It hasn't been the same. From the Old Testament, if you read your Old Testament, when the people of God, the Jewish people, they desperately cried out to God for a king. God said, I'm your king. They said, no, we want to be like what? Other people. And they cried that prayer so often, God relented and said, okay, I'll give you your own king. You're not going to like it. He's going to tax you heavily, way more than I would. He's going to be unjust to you, way more than you would have ever noticed from me. They said, it doesn't matter. Give us the king. So he did. And we have been ruled by kings. All the names, we call them presidents and governors and mayors. We have been ruled by other people since then, when God's original design was to be our king. Will that design be restored one day?
Yes.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's called heaven. Absolutely. It will be restored. There's some other verses there that talk about it. Luke chapter 4, Jesus says, I'm going to leave this place, and I'm going to go so I can preach the kingdom of God to other towns as well. Mark chapter 1 said it this way. The time is fulfilled, Jesus said. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. John said it this way. But my kingdom is not of this world. Jesus came to institute a new kingdom. And we are its citizens. But this is not new. All the way back in the book of Daniel, he said this. He changes times and seasons. He removes kings and sets up kings. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to those who want to understand. Jenny and I did not leave California to come to Washington so that we fled the tyranny of California to come to the beauty of Washington. They believe the same thing politically. All of our friends said, oh, it's about time you're getting out of California. You do not know where we're going? We didn't leave California to get away from anything. We left California to follow God. You see, and that's critical to recognize. Whatever political system or policies or tax level or property tax level there is, you just have to live with that because God called us. You see, you and I have to make a fundamental decision. And Sam, my apologies, I have sacrificed 2 air filters for this survey. I painted on it so you can't read it. So we'll just put B on this one. And this one has a PC. B, Bible. PC, politics and culture. Each of us have to decide how we're going to filter what comes into our lives. Someone said it this way. Where you stand is exactly where you sit. Where you stand on the issues, where you stand on the people, where you stand on the policies, it is determined by where you sit on these issues. What is the primary filter of your life? If the primary filter of your life is politics and culture, then you'll make decisions based upon what filters through that. If the primary filter of your life is God's Word, the Bible, then you'll make decisions based upon that. Where you sit on this issue will determine where you stand when you put the ballot box in, when you bubble in those little marks. And so to help us, we can pray. This is it. This is the message. How you vote is determining where you sit on this. Are you driven by politics and culture and what they say for the blue section? Are you driven by what God says in the Bible and His principles? We can have a whole series and just dive down in each principle and speak to that, but for the rest of the morning, I just want to read a few verses for one of us. It's Mark chapter 15. It's where I had you turn to the beginning. It's a unique situation where Jesus now is present, not in the presence of religious leaders. We're used to seeing him there if you've read the Gospels. He's not in the presence of disciples. We're used to seeing him there teaching from that place. He's in the presence of political leaders. He's in a different realm. He's in Pilate's court. It's towards the end of his life, and the cross is really close. And Jesus stands before Pilate, and Pilate asks 3 questions. Are you the king of the Jews? Why aren't you fighting back? And the crowd asks, what shall we do with the king? So Pilate asks 2, and the crowd asks 1. What shall we do with the king? Pilate asks the crowd. Okay. These 3 questions help us understand Christianity and politics. Here's the first principle I'd like you to get, and it's this. The first question was asked, and Jesus gave a rather ambiguous answer. And I believe wholeheartedly it was intentional, not just an answer. So here's the text. Mark chapter 15, verse 1. As soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and the scribes and the whole council. So it starts with religious leaders. And it says, then they bound Jesus and they led him away and they delivered him over to Pilate. Religious leaders couldn't make certain decisions, so they needed the governing authorities to make those decisions. And so they bound Jesus and they take him to Pilate. Verse 2, and Pilate asked him, are you the king of the Jews? Here's the first question. Are you the king of the Jews? And look at Jesus' answer. And he said to them, you have said so. Are you? Maybe I am. Maybe I'm not.
What kind of answer is that?
Are you the king of the Jews, aren't you? I mean, what would you say? Is Jesus the king of the Jews?
Yes.
Yes! We know that to be true. Why on earth doesn't he way. He knows the answer.
And yet he says to Pilate, and in the original language, it would be as if you was capitalized. You have said so. You are the one who is answering this. Pilate is not a theologian, he's a politician. What Pilate wants to know is what? Is this a hostile takeover? That's all Pilate cares about. Pilate doesn't care one iota about salvation. What Pilate cares about is his power and authority. He is a politician. This is what they care most about, right? This is why it's so frustrating. They get into office and then they spend 6 months making policy and 3.5 years getting back into office. Why? Because they're driven, not all, I'm overstating perhaps, they're driven by the pursuit of power and authority. And Jesus' answer is awesome. It is so awesome that even Pilate says it was awesome. Okay? He says, you have said so, the chief priests accused him of many things, but Jesus just says, as you say, I am and I am not. There's another passage in Mark that helps us understand Jesus' answer. Mark chapter 12. We won't turn there. I'll just summarize. It's a well-known passage where they're wrestling with taxes. And the question comes to Jesus, do your followers pay the taxes? And Jesus just simply responds, I'm not sure. Can you show me a coin? And so they bring him a coin. And then Jesus asked, what picture's on the coin? And they said, well, that's a picture of Caesar that's on the coin. And then Jesus makes the famous statement that many of you probably heard. Well, then render unto Caesar what is Caesar's, and give unto God what is God's. Well, if you flip the coin over, God wasn't there. But God is there. What was Jesus saying? Give to Caesar the taxes that are due him. Remember? I was going to be the king, but now you wanted the king, and now forever you'll be under rulership on earth. So give them what they've asked for, but give to God what he has asked for. What has God asked for? It's all the way back in the book of Genesis. In the image of God, you were created. Male and female, you were created in his image. Whose image is on the coin? Caesar. Well, then give to Caesar what Caesar. What he doesn't say, but what is pregnant in the text is this. The person giving the coin has what stamped on them? The image of God. Give to Caesar what is Caesar, but give to God what is God's. Jesus says, I am a politician, just not your kind. I have something to say about power and authority, just not any way you would imagine. So it is as you say. What about civil disobedience, some people ask? Yeah, it's a good question. We should civilly obey almost always until we shouldn't. You say, well, how do you know? There's some passages that I've listed some there for you. Okay. Perhaps Martin Luther King explained it the best in his letter from Birmingham Jail. After he was thrown in jail for civil disobedience and insurrection, to use the term, he wrote these words, one has not only a legal but a moral responsibility to obey just laws. That's a key phrase, just laws. Conversely, he wrote, one has moral responsibility to disobey unjust laws. So when should we obey? When the laws are just. When should we disobey? When the laws are unjust. I don't think 55 is just, therefore I'm going 60. That's not a license to do whatever you want. That would be incredibly misapplication of Martin Luther King's words. See, there is a law of God that defines justice for us. I don't have time to go into it. And you and I are free to obey the law of the land, politics and culture, or the law of God, the Bible. And we have to make that choice. There's a principle in the Bible called the principle of ultimate allegiance. And our ultimate allegiance is that we belong to God. It is His image that we are stamped with. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. When asked about whether they should share God with other people, Peter and John were commanded in Acts chapter 4, stop preaching about Jesus. You know what they said? We can't. We're going to throw you in jail. Go ahead. We're going to beat you. My pleasure. Because we have an ultimate allegiance to the stamp that we bear. And it is to defend and it is to share the honor of God. Most of us will never be put in that set of circumstances. But where you stand determines what? It's determined by where you stand. You see, Peter and John stood on what God had taught them. You can never stop sharing the truth of God's word. I don't know what politics and culture will ultimately say. But where they sat enabled them to stand up for what is right. When should we civilly disobey? Well, when it's an unjust law. Not just because we don't like the law. That's not fair. The first question was answered in a very ambiguous way and intentionally. Jesus said, I have a politics, I'm just not the same kind of people. That will become clear in just a moment. The second question Jesus answered in a revolutionary way. Look at verse 3, chapter 15 of the Gospel of Mark. He said, the chief priests accused him of many things. And Pilate then again asked Jesus, have you no answer to make? See how many charges they're bringing against you? Charge after charge after charge after charge. We don't know how many they brought against Jesus. It just says the chief priest accused him of many things. And Jesus made no further answer. And how does verse 5 end? What's it say? Pilate was what? Amazed. That word amazed is a specific word. It doesn't mean like, oh, knucklehead. You know, you're amazed when people do stuff that's just so knuckleheadish. These kids are present, can't say stupid. And so, but you're just amazed, right? We use the word amazed that way. This isn't that word. This is the word from Pilate that says he was amazed. Jesus was sat there, silent. He's like, you know, that kind of amazed, like, man, you're good. Really good. He just kept quiet. Pilate says, I'm amazed. I don't know what Pilate was thinking. The word says he was amazed in a marvelous way, beautiful way, not in a dumbfounded way. He was amazed. What was he amazed about? You see, in Pilate's possession were two insurrectionists, Barabbas and Jesus, two revolutionaries, Barabbas and Jesus, two men that wanted to change their world. They just had different strategies. And Pilate had them both in custody. And was his custom, it allowed him to have their power and authority with people, as was his custom, he would surrender. He would release. He would pardon one criminal a year or so, if it brought him more power. And so he's about to do that. And this is what this trial is all about. Which insurrectionist do you want me to release? You see, Jesus' ways were revolutionary. They were just different. Pilate, I think, kind of got a glimpse of it. Do you understand? Christians have been changing the world just in a different way since the beginning of time. You know, Romans used to throw away baby girls. They weren't valuable. Just throw away. You know who changed that policy? Say it. Christians. Because finally the voice rose and said, they're stamped with the image of God. No matter what, our politics or our culture say is right and acceptable, they are stamped with the image of God. In Roman culture, there used to be 140 men for every 100 females. How did those numbers get to be so? And typically, we're within a percentage point or so of each of gender. That's because they thought someone was important. So Christians changed that. How does slavery get changed in our country? If people don't stand up and start saying, people are created in the image of God. How did the double standard of infidelity change? So what do you mean? Well, it was commonplace in culture. For a long time, females had to stay what? Faithful. But the guys could do whatever they wanted. And that was culturally what? Acceptable. You know who changes that? Christians. Time out, somebody finally says. God expects fidelity from everyone. You can't have trust without that. And it's the Christians historically that are leading the charge to care for the poor and the sick and the widows. And that's how people get changed. Who are the ones that charged in to the houses during the plague? Christians. Literally, in some cases, giving their life to care for their neighbor. Change the fabric of culture. Pilate has two insurrectionists in his charge. Two revolutionaries. One, Barabbas. The other, Jesus. Which one will he let go? Barabbas, you see, is just a bully. And bullies will be replaced by what? Another bully. Jesus knows that. Bullies don't change things. They just get more power. That's what they're about. And Jesus knows that somebody will just replace Barabbas. And I think Pilate knows too. That Jesus is playing a longer game. An eternal game. Not a temporary one anymore. Jesus is It takes longer when your approach to power and authority is to serve people. It takes longer to see change happen. It's easy to grab power and find temporal change. It's a whole lot more difficult to see lasting change. But we know this fundamental truth. Where you sit on the Bible, and God's word is where you will stand. Or if you sit on politics and culture as your guiding authority, that's where you will stand when you bubble in that balcony. You see, Jesus had a completely different approach. A revolutionary approach. He didn't fend for himself. He was willing to go through. He knew. You kill me and the revolution breaks out. You release me, there'll just be another Barabbas. Jesus is about starting the revolution. He's about takeover. He's not about parties or sides. He's about taking over the hearts and minds of men and women. The last question is perhaps the most important one. And it makes it more clear. The first was ambiguous. I'm a politician, but not your kind. The second question, he was silent on because he knew a revolution was coming. And it was going to start with the cross. The third answer is one that we'll call substitutionary. Mark chapter 15, verse 6. He says, now at the feast he used to release for them one prisoner, from whom they asked. And among the rebels in prison who had committed murder and insurrection, there was a man named Barabbas. And the crowd came up and began to ask Pilate to do as he usually did for them. And he answered them, saying, Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews? But Pilate's already made up in his mind. What does he care? This is not a revolutionary movement that I'm concerned with. This guy, this Jesus, is not after my power. He's not after my seeds. I, therefore, don't care about him. This other guy, Barabbas, I care about. Why? And he is burning the city. He's got people up in arms. They care about this guy. So, like every good politician, Pilate says what? Let's get rid of this guy. Let me give you Jesus, right? He's not done anything wrong. And I don't really care because he's not a bother. Do you want me to release the king of the Jews? Verse 10. For he perceived that it was out of envy that the chief priests had delivered him up. See, he's smart. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him released for them Barabbas instead. And Pilate again said to them, then what shall I do with the man you call king of the Jews? And they cry out, crucify him. And Pilate said to them, why? What evil has he done? But they shouted all the more, crucify him. So Pilate, like a good politician, that's not in the text. Pilate, like a good politician, wants to appease the crowd. Wishing to satisfy the crowd, he releases for them Barabbas. Folks, the only thing that has changed is we now see it on TV instead of written in stories. People have been doing this. Release for me Barabbas. And having scourged Jesus, they delivered him to be crucified. You see, here's the issue with this illustration. This seated on the Bible, the principles that it offers you, or being driven by politics and culture, it is not something you could be haphazard, because this one leads to that. You can't stand by and just watch that happen. This Jesus, he died for you. My God, whose image that you have imprinted upon you, died for you. That was how he sparked the revolution. And I, just put yourself in the shoes of the politician for a moment, right? Maybe the shoes of the religious leaders better, yeah. Jesus now put on a cross, crucified, dead, and they put him in a grave. We've sealed it and everybody saw it. The revolution is what? It's over, right? It's over. Jesus is gone. We put that baby to bed. Let's move. We got power back. This is why some have called the resurrection the greatest political coup ever. Because it wasn't over. It was just beginning. You see, Jesus is about a takeover. Jesus is not throwing people into heaven who don't want to be there.
Don't get me wrong when I say takeover. Okay?
But Jesus is also not just willing to be second fiddle. That's not how it works. There's lots of things that God cannot do. And play well in the sandbox with others is one of them. He's large and in charge. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. It's the greatest beauty of the gospel. It's a paradox. This ambiguousness. Every political movement does this one thing. It simply puts new people in power. That's all it does. And what Jesus came to offer us is a new attitude about power. Power doesn't come because you have title or recognition. Power comes because you what? The greatest among you will be your... There it is. Jesus wanted to transform the very way we thought about power. In our day, people vote for candidates that will give them what they want. Release Barabbas. It's what the people wanted. They wanted that immediate overthrow. They wanted that revolution. What Jesus offered was something more long-term. And a lot of people don't get that distinction. They want what they want today, rather than believing God for eternity. So you have to decide where you sit, because where you sit will determine where you sit. Do you sit with the Bible as the foundation and filter for your life, or with politics and culture? Because that will guide you. And yeah, there's chapters and verses and principles that will guide you in what to bubble, and I've not done a great job, perhaps, of explaining what issues are most important on your heart and mind. What I'm trying to do is simply this. In Acts chapter 17, a statement is made. These men who have turned the world upside down have come here also. These men, he was talking about the apostles. Okay? We can say men or women and be appropriate. These men or women who have turned the world upside down, talking about followers of Jesus. How did he do it? Not a single vote was passed. Not a single policy did they write. How did they do it? They served people. They loved people. And the world has forever been different. Luke chapter 1 says it this way. He brought down the mighty from their thrones and exalted those of humble estate. What God is looking for most of all is men and women who serve him. That is the revolution. That is the substitution. Jesus said, I will step in for them and die for them. You can't be on the sidelines for that. You can't watch them all. That's what God calls us to consider. Was Jesus a politician? Yes, no. Was Jesus a revolutionary? Absolutely. But it wasn't about putting people in power. It was about helping us think differently about the very nature. And the quicker we understand that, the more influence we will have. Now, is it true that God calls people into politics? Is that true? Absolutely. Is it true that people in our church are involved in helping run policies and running for office? Is that true? Absolutely. Because God has our hand on them. He's asked them to do those things. And we honor them and support that in them. Nothing I've said should diminish their passion for their causes. What I've been talking about, though, is something different. What I've been talking about is the revolution that God wants to have in you. Not about position, it's not about power. It's about serving other people. Why? So they might consider you. That's our soul. I don't know how you're going to vote. I don't know if this has been helpful. We can talk later. But I do know this. That this substitutionary visit from Jesus, that he was willing to die on the cross for our sins. We need it. All of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And so when we come to celebrate communion, if you're a guest with us, you're more than welcome. If you're visiting, part-timer, full-timer, member, non-member, whatever category you can offer here, people sometimes think, well, I shouldn't take it. If you believe in Jesus, it's here for you. That's what we believe. That's what communion is for. The Bible says as often as you take this, we do it in the remembrance of what God has done. That he died for us. He served us. And as long as we are here, we're here to continue the revolution. And serving other people so that they can come to him. And have their life transformed. That's what this is about. So I've touched base with about five people, so I'm going to ask them to come on up. They're going to help serve the community. I'm just going to pray for the elements. Our tradition here is that there is a cup and a grape juice that resembles his blood, and then there's a little wafer, there's a cup, actually, and the little round
and just kind of take one and hold it. We'll partake together. Why? Really just symbolic. That we're part of the same revolution. We're part of the same party. We're part of the same family of God. And so if you will have a time of prayer, if you get something right before we take communion, we'll allow you to do that as the elders pass. Beth and Aaron will lead a song. You can sing, you can be quiet. I'll leave us in prayer. Let me pray. Father, thank you for caring more about bubbles on a piece of paper. You care about our souls. And you sent your Son to transform us. And Jesus, thank you for not making us robots, for being ambiguous and allowing us to approach these issues as we are gifted and as we are equipped to do so. But also equipping us with the fundamental change of how power really works and how it matters. The true power and true authority comes through serving others. This communion table represents that most of all. We collectively together today, we celebrate by saying thank you for dying for us. Thank you for sharing your blood as a sacrifice for us to take care of sin problem of all people. I'm grateful for that this morning. In Jesus' name. Jesus started came because a meal. He took a piece of bread, and they didn't completely understand the imagery of the meal. Later, he would take them some time. Paul would write about it in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. He would say, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread. And he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, 'This is my body, this is for you. Do this in remembrance.'" His body broken as a payment for our sin because human nature needed some help. Later in that meal, he would take a cup and he said, "This cup represents a new covenant, a new way of thinking. It's gonna, only God can take the redness of blood and make something white." He said, "In the same way also, he took a cup after supper, saying, 'The cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.'" He closed that meal by saying, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink of the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Father, thank you for allowing us today to celebrate the freedom, the proclamation of what you sent your son to do. Jesus, thank you for teaching us the power and authority may or may not come and be about, but we know for sure it comes through service. Through serving of others, which you have done for us, you have set in the example. We'll never be perfect at it, Lord, but help us this week as we depart this place. For families, for our businesses, our neighbors, to this side, to west side, wherever we go, that they may see you in us, and the revolution will continue. In Jesus' name. We do have in the back, and we'll talk more next week in the message about this, but we do have in the back our sign up for life groups. If you want to be in a life group, some groups have openings, you may have never been in a life group, if you have some questions about it, just give us your contact information back there, and we'll be glad to contact you this week. We'll talk more about it next week. All right, God bless you.